Welcome to the Menil. I am Theodore Bale, Assistant Director of Public Programs here at the Menil Collection, and tonight it is my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Gary Vikan. Before I had read Gary's fascinating new memoir, Sacred and Stolen, Confessions of a Museum Director, I was very captivated by a paragraph in his press release, which reads, Vikan lectures extensively on topics as varied as Byzantine art, Elvis Presley, the Shroud of Turin, looted art and cultural property policy, neuroaesthetics, and art forgeries. He also happens to be an internationally known medieval scholar as well. Dr. Vikan holds a BA from Carleton College, a PhD from Princeton University, and he is a graduate of both the Harvard Program for Art Museum Directors and the National Arts Strategies Chief Executive Program. He was a senior associate at Harvard Center for Byzantine Studies at Dumbarton Oaks in Washington, D.C. During his tenure as director of the Walters Art Museum in Baltimore, Dr. Vikan led the contextual installation of the museum's collections, eliminated its general admission fee, like the Menil Collection, and provided open access to all of its digital assets among his many accomplishments. Please welcome Dr. Gary Vikan.
Little echoey. Okay. So I can see you out there. Yes, I can. Anyway, being in Houston for the first time in years brings back memories. At the age of 31 in 1978, I began working for Dominique de Menil. I was then unemployed at that point, so I very much appreciated getting the job of cataloging some of her Byzantine small items, which you may or may not ever have seen. The point is, she picked me up at the airport in July of 1978, and I then lived in Washington, and I thought I knew what heat was. I did not. Black Mercedes, wood paneling. She picked me up at the airport. We stopped at the Barnett Newman inverted column. She told me the story of Martin Luther King, the dedication, and how she took it over back from the city. Then she drove me to the house. We sat down in the living room, and she poured me a whiskey. And I didn't ask for the whiskey. She just poured me a whiskey. And it was secreted, so to speak, in that little surreal cabinet with, as I recall, fur inside or some such. And she put on Bessie Smith. And I thought, I'm in a fantasy land. I stayed in the guest house that night, and yesterday I was here. And when I was here, I walked through the surreal installation just to our left, and I saw the Max Ernst, the third one, the horizontal one. And I recall that that was above my bed in the guest room. And before that, I'd seen the De Chirico, and I recall that was in my study. And I think the Picasso was in the house as well. But what struck me, or the memory that came back to me, was somebody on the staff of the Menil Foundation, as I worked for one steady week in the heat on the Rice University campus, where the storage then was, and in the house, somebody took me to Jamail's. Does that ring a bell with anybody here? Yes, somebody remembers this very fancy grocery store where they had swivel chairs in front of the butcher. And I marveled at that. And I would get the fattest steak that money could buy, since I otherwise had no expenses. And I would take this steak back to this little guest house, which is about the size of this foyer, and I would fry it. You know, the stove as hot as it would get, so I could really sear the steak. So the whole house would just be filled with smoke. And I'd turn around and look at that Max Ernst and that Picasso and think to myself, maybe this is not a good idea. So if you go in there when the security folks aren't in there and get your nose as close to the Max Ernst as you possibly can, you may smell the smoke of a Delmonico steak. It's not impossible. The last time I was in this, in fact, the only time I was in this museum until yesterday, was the fall of 1988. And I was standing right here. And Walter Hopps, how many people remember Walter Hopps? How many people remember that Walter had a temper? Yes. And I was standing here, he was standing there, Dominique was standing here, and there was a bar with wine and who knows what. And it was a reception that coincided with the Byzantine Studies Conference, which is the convening of all the Byzantinists, and yes, there are more than three in the United States. Now, all the Byzantinists in the United States, plus a whole bunch from around the world, the reason they came to Texas on the 11th of November, 1988, was for the epiphany of what was in that room leaning against the wall. And those were the frescoes from the little chapel outside of Lisi in northern Cyprus. They'd just been shipped from London after 4 years of restoration. So the restorer, Larry Morocco, was here, as was Yanni Petsopoulos, who was the dealer go-between, and I'll get to that in just a minute. But I'll never forget what Walter said as I was standing here after I told him a little story. He said, and I've never heard anybody use this expression, he's very angry at a specific staff member, "I'll rip her tongue out." Now, to find out who that staff member was and why Walter was so eager to rip her tongue out, you know, he said it with such intensity that I could imagine her standing over his right shoulder. She wasn't in the room at the time I checked when I did the that chapter. Anyway, lots of good memories, and I'll tell you a little story. On the left is the cover of my book. I got my PhD from Princeton in 1976. I'm a Byzantinist, which means I study all things Eastern and medieval, and so happens that I got my PhD almost exactly, well, let's say 2 years later, after Northern Cyprus was invaded by Turkey. And you would not necessarily have known this, but if you wanted to find a place that was, in effect, an outdoor and indoor museum of medieval Christianity, Orthodox Christianity, Byzantium, it was Cyprus. What I could not have guessed was in the first 4 or 5 years of the occupation of the 37% of that northern part of the island, Turkey systematically denuded, de-orthodoxed the churches of the island. The intent was to make them effectively religiously uninhabitable. This was not simply looting for the sake of getting assets to sell on the European and American market. This was destroying churches. And if you know anything about Orthodoxy, you know that an Orthodox church cannot function as a church without sacred images. If you take the icons, the frescoes, and mosaics out, the church is no longer a church. And it was very clear from that action that Turkey never intended to come to terms with the rest of Cyprus and have a pluralistic society again in the north. So that's me. That's what my book is about. And specifically two churches is what the story I'm going to tell you this evening, which involve a total of four chapters in the book. The one on the left is from the 6th century, and it's Panagia Kanakoria, and it's on the northeast finger that sticks out of the island. And you can see right above it are the mosaics that were in the apse. And while those mosaics may seem a little weak and tawdry, they are precious beyond belief because they are one of a handful, and less, in fact, than a handful, of surviving church mosaics in the Byzantine Empire. So even though they're damaged, and even though that church is fairly small in a rural part of the Byzantine Empire, because these things are so rare, that church was precious beyond belief. And at the right, as you're looking at it, is a small chapel, much smaller than this atrium space, just outside the town of Lisi in northern Cyprus. And that's the more left of those vertical blue arrows coming down. And that church had a dome fresco in it and an apse fresco in it. And I can tell you that within 4 or 5 years after the occupation, the populations of the city, of these two towns, that were Greek and Orthodox were sent away. First, some of them were taken to Turkey and beat up and imprisoned for a while. Then they all came back, put on buses, and they were taken to the Green Line and pushed to the other side. And so these churches were empty, and then people went in with full knowledge of the Turkish occupation and ripped the frescoes and the mosaics off the wall. The mosaics ended up in at least 13 pieces, the frescoes in 38 pieces. So they all converged in one warehouse in Munich. Why? Because the money man, the go-between between the people that were actually cutting them off the wall using canvas and rubber cement and crowbars and rotary saws, and the market, places like New York, London, and Paris, was a man named Aidan Diekman, a Turk who was a well-known smuggler. And it was his apartment and his cash that filled his apartment with not tens or dozens or even hundreds of icons, thousands of Greek icons, Byzantine icons, ended up in his warehouses in Munich. And this was true beginning in the early 80s. And the warehouse, for reasons that you will discover in the book, was not raided until 1998. At least 15 years after everybody who cared knew exactly where that stuff was. So all of it's in his warehouse, and now the most important pieces have all gone back to Nicosia. You can see the dome fresco, which for you in Texas is very familiar, because until 2012, 5 years ago, almost this month, I think, those frescoes were in the wonderful chapel designed by Francois de Menil. And the mosaics below, cut up, are now also back in this tiny little museum in Nicosia, just below the Green Line. So that happy ending is, I guess, given the way things started, the most one could hope for. But how those two sets of things made it back to that museum involved two women and two very different paths. Both women fell in love, and these are quotes, with their respective loot. The one on the left is Peg Goldberg, a small-time contemporary art dealer in a suburb of Indianapolis. And she was the conduit for the mosaics. And the one on the right, you all know, there she's doing some work with Walter Hopps, a photograph taken in the late 80s of Dominique de Menil. That's the woman that I remember. That's the wispy, spiritual woman that I worked with off and on for 5 years. And she was the one that got the mosaics, or the frescoes, back. But the paths they took were very different. Peg Goldberg was a pigeon, but a willing pigeon. She was set up by a co-dealer in Indianapolis named Bob Fitzgerald. And Bob Fitzgerald came to Peg's office one day in suburban Indianapolis and said, "Peg, I've got a Modigliani painting in Amsterdam, which I think you have a client for." So sure enough, Bob Fitzgerald and Peg Goldberg ended up in Indianapolis with a line of credit with her banker for £3 million in order that she could buy the Modigliani and in turn flip it over to a Japanese buyer. She'd never traded anything above $100,000, so this was a big moment for her. What she didn't know was that her cohort, her seeming partner in this, Bob Fitzgerald from Indianapolis, knew it was a fake. And the whole point was to get Peg Goldberg in Amsterdam with a lot of money in her hand and disappointed. So it's the 1st of July, 1988, and Peg Goldberg and Bob Fitzgerald, who is not the man above her in the slide, are having coffee at the Marriott Hotel just to the east, just to the west of the Rijksmuseum. And that's me, by the way, standing under the awning, since I went to all of these places as part of my investigation. Anyway, in walks a man by the name of Michel Van Rijn, and he introduces himself with two interesting pieces of information. First, he's descended on his mother's side from Peter Paul Rubens and on his father's side from Rembrandt. and secondarily, that he has been convicted of a felony in France for having forged signatures on Chagall prints. He claims he didn't do it, but that was just transparency on his part. Then he produces four photographs of four mosaics, and he says, these mosaics come from a Byzantine church in Cyprus that has been destroyed. They were retrieved from this destroyed church by a Turkish archaeologist who lives in Munich, who now has liver cancer. The Turkish archaeologist in Munich with liver cancer must sell these precious mosaics, and I would buy them myself, says Michel Van Rijn, there with the phone up to his ear, but I'm cash poor, so I'll pass this opportunity on to you, and they're $3 million. Interesting number. Peg says, oh, that's a lot of money, but she immediately fell in love with the mosaics and the prospect of having them. So eventually, after some negotiation, she got the number down to $1 million, to which was added $80,000 fee for the lawyer who walked in after this guy. So there were three of them at the coffee on the other side of the table from her with the four photographs. $80,000 for his good work, and she tacked on $120,000 for carrying costs for herself, expenses. Now realize she's in Amsterdam, so $120,000 to get her from Amsterdam back to Indianapolis. She called her banker up and said, I need $1.2 million in cash in the Geneva airport within 4 days in order that I can buy these mosaics. And by the way, they can be appraised. I'll have appraisals for them at $5 million. So it's a fire sale, but really a sale that's generated by the fact that the present owner, a Turkish archaeologist, as she understood him to be, has liver cancer. Ergo, he has to dump the merchandise and nobody else has the cash. So her banker in Indianapolis, in his pajamas, says, yes, I'll give you $1.2 million on one condition, that I get 5% of the resale. Fine. So they're in the Geneva airport. The mosaics are in boxes on the floor. Diekman never shows up. The smuggler is never there. She passes the money, $120,000 of strapped $100 bills, onto the two guys who have set her up, one of whom is Michel Van Rijn, the other one is Bob Fitzgerald. They are so clever, though, they insist to her that since these things are really worth $5 million and we're selling them to you for only $1 million, we want some piece of the resale. So between the two, they got 45%. So do you get the picture now? She goes to the banker. The banker gives her $1.2 million. She puts $120,000 in her pocket so she can safely get back to her home in a suburb of Indianapolis. She gives $80,000 to the lawyer who wrote up the contract. $1 million goes to Fitzgerald and Van Rijn, but because they've discounted this and because it's worth much more than that, and by the way, they're the ones that wrote the appraisals for $5 million, they between them get 45% of the resale. Now, what she didn't learn until much later was they in fact paid Diekman, the smuggler, only $350,000. So this is what good con people do. With no money out of pocket themselves, with no more assets than four photographs, they were able to turn a $650,000 back to themselves for 4 days' work. She sends him back to Indianapolis. Some tesserae fall off. In the meantime, she has the tesserae glued back on with Elmer's glue. So the United States eventually finds out about this. They can't do anything through customs. So finally, the government of Cyprus and the Church of Cyprus together decide to sue her in civil court in Indianapolis, in her own backyard, for the return of what they identify as stolen property. I enter at that point, right at the middle of this picture. I'm that fuzzy little guy in the middle looking very earnest. Huh? You see me there? Anyway, that's Peg on the right. And on the left, it's Father Pavlos, who came to Indianapolis to represent the Church of Cyprus. So the trial went on for about a week, and it all hinged on which tried harder. Did Cyprus do enough good work to get the message out that their churches had been violated? And had they tried to get the mosaics back? I said, yes, they had tried hard. I was interviewed and spoke to them years earlier at Dumbarton Oaks when I was there, a scholar. Pei Goldberg, did she try hard enough? No, she didn't. And the final testimony on my part went this way. As many doubts as she may have had about where these had come from, as many suspicions as she could have had about a Turk who claimed to be an archaeologist who was selling ancient artifacts from an extinct church in a war zone, artifacts which she now at trial knew the smuggler got $350,000 for, and which had been appraised for $5 million after a million had changed hands, mosaics which had been offered 3 months after they arrived in the United States to the Getty Museum in Los Angeles for $20 million, right? If all of that made sense to her, all she had to do, if she had any doubts, was to put her finger in that good old rotary phone there in Geneva and call the consulate from Cyprus and say, is this okay with you guys? Well, she didn't. She lost the trial. It was on the front page of the New York Times. It finally went back. You might ask yourself, after all this, how did it all turn out? Well, Diekmann, the smuggler, got his $350,000. Michel Van Rijn and Bob Fitzgerald split, not only did they split the $650,000, in the course of the trial, when a loan she had taken out to cover the outlay came due, Fitzgerald and Van Rijn sold half of their 45% to a physician in Indianapolis named Stuart Blick for $780,000. And another 5% to the banker. So when it was all over, who was out? Nobody went to jail. The mosaics went back for Cyprus, as you saw. The Pei Goldberg was out nothing, zero, because she had no assets. She had no money in the game. The person who was out $1.5 million, because he had to cover court costs, was Otto Nick Frenzel, who was the president of the Merchants Bank in Indianapolis, that huge bank which was right next to the courthouse. So he was quoted on the front page of the Wall Street Journal when he had to pay off the net loss of $1.5 million out of his own pocket to his own bank. He said, quote, it caused some embarrassment. So this is me in the early 1980s with my dog. See, I told you I had a dog. The dog is now deceased, you might guess. That's Lulu. But I had worked for Dominique de Menil. I did a small exhibition on security in Byzantium that was based on some of the little bronzes she bought in the early, and she and her husband bought actually in 1962. So I knew her, and I'd worked for her for 2 years. And as I said, it all began with that whiskey and in the living room in 1978. But I was by that point working at Dumbarton Oaks, which is the Harvard Research Center on the north edge of Georgetown in Washington, D.C. And I just bought an icon, which I later found out was stolen, for Dumbarton Oaks of St. Peter. And it's still at Dumbarton Oaks, and it's still stolen. But I was celebrating my purchase with a small exhibition. And in that small exhibition, by the way, were a couple of icons that are in a gallery right over there, the Martina and the one right next to it. So right after the exhibition, it's April 28th, 1983, the next morning, and I'm feeling very good about myself because we got a half page in the New York Times on this little exhibition of icons surrounding this St. Peter, which I knew by then had been stolen, but nobody really cared in those days. It was kind of the Wild West, that there was a whole different set of rules that governed what went on. But in any event, somebody came, a guy by the name of Yanni Petsopoulos, a Greek who dealt out of London, Byzantine things. He's still around. The last thing I bought as director of the Walters Art Museum was from Yanni Petsopoulos. So he endures, and I guess I do too. Anyhow, he came into my office and he said, may I close the door? I said, sure, fine. And he came in and closed the door and he said, I'm going to show you and tell you something in absolute confidence you must never tell. I said, sure. Stupid thing to do. So out come these two photographs. And the one on the right is a drawing of what looked to me like a Middle Byzantine church, 13th, 14th century. And he said, you know, what I'm showing you here is a church that was dug up in the sands of southwest Turkey by some people who were digging the foundations for a youth hostel. It's interesting. Then he showed me the photograph on the left, and he says, well, this is the fresco in the dome of that church with these cut lines on it. And I didn't know if it had been cut by that time or they just intended to cut it. And he said, look, these frescoes are going to be cut up, and they're going to be sent all over the world. And I'm here to ask you if you know anybody who can step in and save them. He also showed me the apse with the cut lines on it, so it's not broken up in a bunch of pieces. And I says, well, you can't buy the interior of a church. You just can't do that. Somebody's going to find out. He says, no, there's no problem. They'll put sand over the top of it, and they'll build this youth hostel. Well, I didn't think that was true. I assumed these things came from Cyprus. And I knew someday, if you buy the interior of a church, the church is going to turn up. And when the church turns up, somebody's going to be angry. And it's just not something you could do. And I said, Dunbar Oaks can't get near this. And he says, well, how about Dominique de Menil? I'm going down there. He says, no, she can't do this either. They're about to be, they told me about this museum. Walter Hobbs told me that there's going to be a museum. It's going to open in the later 80s. And I said, there's no way any credible museum in the United States can buy the inside of a church, no matter where it comes from. You just can't do that. So he went away. I got a call from Mary Jane Victor. How many people in this room know who Mary Jane Victor is? Very nice woman. She was my helper here. Mary Jane Victor called me, and we're just passing the time. And she says, you know, Yanni Petsopoulos is coming to see Dominique. And I said, yeah, I know that. And by the way, there was one icon I couldn't get for my exhibition. It's a John the Baptist icon. I saw it in a penthouse in New York. I don't mention it in the book, but at the penthouse belongs to the brother of the last surviving royalty of Greece. He goes by one name only, preceded by the word prince. He's a penthouse very on Park Avenue, very near the Met, and I'd been in the penthouse. And there were three icons in the penthouse, and two of which I borrowed for that exhibition I told you about, the one that opened and the guy came up to the second floor, Yanni came up and all the rest. The best of the three was of John the Baptist, 14th century. I knew it was from Cyprus, but it was spectacular. So I said, Mary Jane, when Yanni comes down here, down to Texas, ask him about the John the Baptist icon. That's all you have to say. Ask him about that. He may be willing to sell it. Now, what happened between that phone call and Bertrand Davizac showing up in London a month and a half later, I cannot exactly say, but I speculate in my memoir that the transmission of my message got a little garbled. I suspect Mary Jane Victor said to Bertrand Davizac, Yanni Petsopoulos is coming down here and he's got something very important. I suspect she didn't say that it was the John the Baptist icon. So when Bertrand Davizac sees Yanni Petsopoulos, he says, Yanni, Vikan tells me you've got something that's really important that we would be interested in. Petsopoulos brings out his three photographs. That one and the third one of the apse. Beckman turns around and shows them to Dominique. I'm collapsing the story slightly. She falls in love. Less than 3 weeks later, they're in Munich in Diekmann's apartment. The day after they leave Diekmann's apartment, I was on vacation in Minnesota. I got a phone call from Walter Hopps. And the message was, since I wasn't there to pick up the phone when he called, call from Paris. He said, call after midnight, Paris time. I'd never, at that point, spoken to Walter directly. So I called him after midnight, having by that time figured out he was in Dominique's apartment in Paris and he didn't want to hear what the conversation was about. He was livid, absolutely livid at me, because he assumed that I had directed Bertrand Davizac to ask Yanni Petsopoulos about the frescoes, which I had not done. So on that phone call, I said, I appreciate you have a problem. I had no idea why he was so angry at me until about a half a year later, and you will discover that in the book. I know you have a problem, but if you want to get this problem off the back, you're only one thing you can do. You have to write to every government of every nation from which this set of frescoes might have come. And if they can prove that they come from that territory, put the money in escrow. They can prove it, you don't buy. Well, that began a process which took about 6 months. And out of that process came the deal, and a great pain to me and others that finally turned the frescoes and mosaics, or the frescoes in 38 pieces, over to Dominique de Menil, who over 4 years, as I said, repaired them in London and brought them here, where I saw them in that room, the dome leaning against the wall, and then eventually into Francois's beautiful chapel. So it all turned out fairly happily, even though the path there was very circuitous and sometimes extremely painful. And I would not have guessed, even when I began to write my memoir in the fall of 2013, that there could be an afterlife to that strange interlude. And the afterlife came about, actually, thanks to, if you can put it that way, ISIS. When they started to destroy statuary in Mosul in March of 2015, almost exactly 2 years ago, it got everybody's attention when they beheaded the official in Palmyra the following August. Everybody's attention was galvanized. And this got not only the attention of the popular press and all of you who are fully aware of these things, thanks to now the accessibility of social media and images that ISIS themselves provided, but legislation was introduced in Congress, which would have in effect, have totally eliminated any physical movement of cultural property out of either Iraq or Syria to the West. And I thought that was a mistake. And I thought that was a mistake for two reasons. One is that ISIS had only marginal, and has even less now, marginal control over those two countries. So there are vast areas in both Syria and Iraq which are being looted as they have been looted for 150 years by locals. And locals are now even more desperate than they were 100 years ago when they were digging up Byzantine silver and selling it in Paris to Henry Walters of the Walters Art Museum. They're desperate. And if we close our borders to that material, I said, because I spent time on Capitol Hill talking to people who drafted that legislation, it'll turn around and go back to ISIS and be destroyed. So I am happy to say that thanks to the example of Dominique de Menil and those frescoes, the notion of and wordage to in the legislation to safe harbor was accepted and adopted and now exists as part of American law. So that's the story of the frescoes and mosaics. And I'm going to tell you another story if you have time. Do you have time for a totally different story? Did anybody nodding here? Did the dog have time? Okay. This is the last chapter. Now, you've all heard about the looting, or the theft, actually, from the Isabella Stewart Gardner Museum. March 16th, 1900. Some of you may have heard about the recent return of the two Van Goghs to Amsterdam, to the Van Gogh Museum in Amsterdam, which had been stolen, 17 years ago. What I'm saying is, when you steal something, sometimes it stays away a long time. I think the longest duration of theft, if that's the right word, does that mean we're being spoken to by spirits? Was this little Renoir. Summer of 2012, all over the newspapers, Good Morning America, USA Today. What are you reading about? Renoir girl. Who's Renoir girl? She's a middle-aged woman who keeps her identity private. She lives in Northern Virginia. She knows nothing about art, and she's all but destitute. And one day in 2009, a couple years earlier, she says she went to a flea market in Harpers Ferry, Virginia, and at that flea market bought three things in one lot. One was a plastic cow, one was a Paul Bunyan doll, and the third was this thing, with a little hint about what it is in the form of that plaque at the bottom center, this painting. What did she pay for the lot? $7, okay? So she forgot about it. But her 82-year-old mother, after 3 years, said, Renoir girl, although she didn't call her Renoir girl around the house, I don't think, Renoir girl, why don't you take it to Potomac Appraisers in Northern Virginia, which is where she took it, have them look at it and see if it's worth anything. Potomac Appraisers said, oh, this Renoir, yes, it is a Renoir. It was painted in 1879 on a little linen napkin. It was painted at a restaurant on the banks of the Seine, and he dashed it off after lunch, and he gave it to his girlfriend. And yes, it's a known painting because it was sold through a dealer in Paris in 1926. And by the way, it's worth $70,000 to $100,000 at auction. This is when it hit the press. What a fantastic fairy tale. This poor woman in Northern Virginia didn't even heard the name of Renoir in her life. For $7, and she wanted the Paul Bunyan doll. That's all she cared about. She got this thing, so she took it down to the Potomac Appraisers in a garbage bag. One of the white ones, you know, they're scented, you know that? So it's in a garbage bag, and her mother says, take it down there, you know, you're gonna find out. Mother was 82, as I said, daughter was then in her 50s. Daughter's keeping it quiet. The auction is gonna take place on the 27th of September, 2012. Again, Good Morning America, USA Today, New York Times, Wall Street Journal, it's all over. And so everybody thought in the business, especially people who live fairly near Harper's Ferry, maybe this thing is stolen. Renoirs just don't go popping up at flea markets for nothing. And by the way, that 1926 sale from the gallery in Paris was to a lawyer from Philadelphia, a wealthy man named Adler. And by the way, Adler married a shoe company heiress from Baltimore named Sadie May. Sadie May Adler, if you go to the Baltimore Museum of Art and you bend down and look carefully, with information that you don't see on the labels here, but in Baltimore we put where these things came from, and so Sadie May's name is all over the place because she gifted what she and her husband had collected over decades to the Baltimore Museum of Art, and mostly that's Impressionist and Post-Impressionist painting. Fantastic stuff. So anybody would have thought, well, maybe this was among them. So the Baltimore Museum of Art, in its wisdom, went to its index file and into his computer file, and especially his index, his card file. Was this ever in the possession of the Baltimore Museum of Art? They said no. Reporter from the Washington Post said that's not good enough. He went to Harper's Ferry and he couldn't find the auction house. He couldn't find the flea market. Made him suspicious. Then he went to the Baltimore Museum of Art and went to the library and said to the librarian, do you have an archival file on Sadie May Adler? She says, yes, we do. In the file was a little card that was peach colored, and the little card said on the front with a picture, a little teeny weeny picture of this thing. On loan to the Baltimore Museum of Art, Baltimore Museum of Art, 1937. Sadie May Adler. Turned over the card, it said stolen. Overnight, November 14 to 15, 1951. He told Potomac Appraisers, Potomac appraisers call the FBI. The FBI seizes the painting. The painting goes before a judge, eventually 6 months later, decide who should get the painting. In the meantime, Renoir girl identifies herself. She is the daughter of a woman who was, in 1951, a junior in art history at Goucher College in Baltimore, Maryland. Interesting. She's the daughter of a woman who taught art out of her home for decades in suburban Washington, D.C. Interesting. Who was in those classes and who helped mom all that time? Well, the daughter did, who happened now to be 51 years old. Yes, she was all but indigent. A driving school instructor in Northern Virginia. Her name is Marcia Fuqua. Her mother's name is Marcia Fouquet. Mom is 82, daughter 51. So it all begins to look a little suspicious. Brother Matt, Marcia's brother Matt, who despises his sister, tells a reporter from Washington Post that painting was on our wall from the 50s. Mom said it came from a museum in Baltimore. Mom has cancer. She said we have to give it back. It would only be right. He doesn't quite finish the sentence, but the implication is that when mom is about to put her mitt on this thing and call the BMA and said, this painting belongs to you, why don't you come and pick it up? I'm sorry about, you know, the last 63 years. That her daughter swoops in and takes it, which is exactly what happened. She waits 3 years and then shows up with a garbage bag at Potomac Appraisers. Fine. When I saw 1951 in the newspapers, November 14th, I knew who had stolen the painting. I knew in an instant who'd stolen the painting. Why? Set the clock back to 1986. I'm at the Walters Art Museum. I'm chief curator. In comes the mail, and in the mail is a book mailer, the kind that has that fuzz inside. If you open it the wrong way, it gets all over the place. And inside that book mailer was a little plaque. And the plaque was clearly and obviously to me early Christian from Egypt. Not especially fancy in technique and material, but very rare and important, and it'll look familiar. So I went to our card file, flipped through our card file, I found a card that looked just like this thing. I said, wow, the Walters has one too, very much like this. I looked a little more closely, it looked exactly the same. Turned the card over and it said, stolen. October 2nd, 1951. So I cogitated on that for about 2 days, and then I got a call from the Johns Hopkins Museum. And the Johns Hopkins Museum said, something very strange happened to us this week. I said, what's that? On the 1st of May, we got a mailer, a book mailer, and in the book mailer were materials that were stolen from our museum in 1951. So I went back to the mailer. See it there? Now, this thing was sent by somebody who I thought was a Mr. or a Mrs. For reasons I can't explain, I thought a woman had sent us this thing. And I thought her name was like Rachel or Rebecca. And she just gave her first initial. My assumption was she was really old. Because after all, it had been stolen in 1951. So, you know, that's a long time ago. And maybe she's getting old and she wants to make things right. And her name is R. Period Egret, right? And it comes from Church Street in Manhattan, and I knew the Church Street was in Manhattan, and the zip code was 10028. So I'm looking at this mailer again once I've gotten this phone call from the Johns Hopkins Museum, and I said, geez, R. Egret, regret, Church Street. I'll look up the zip code. There is no post office at Church Street. I look up the zip code, and it's about a mile north of Church Street. So it was an act not simply of regret, it was an act of repentance. Somebody was making something right. So I went to, you know, this wonderful museum is a lot like the Walters, where people stay for a long time. So I went to one of our longtime staff members and I said, who in Baltimore, Maryland, in 1951 would have access to two different museums? It didn't take her 60 seconds. She says, I know. It was a guy who was very good at packing and building mounts And he eventually became a conservator. Yes, and she gave me the guy's name. I just held that in my head for a while. 3 months go by to the day. Realized my first exhibition at the Walters was silver treasure from early Byzantium. And a bunch of silver that had been dug up in the early 20th century and dispersed around the world, I reassembled the treasure. And I wanted one loan from the Baltimore Museum of Art of a silver bowl that was dug up in Syria in 1935. And I wrote them a little formal letter and they said, I'm sorry to say we can't find it. You know, that's not my problem. So in the catalog was a photograph, and in the exhibition was a photograph. The exhibition had been on for 3.5 months. The Byzantine Congress was coming to the Walters on the 5th of August, just like they'd come to here on the 11th of November, 1988. They were in Baltimore on the 5th of August, 1986. And what should happen? But 4 days before their arrival, Baltimore Museum of Art calls me up and he says, we found the bowl. I says, where was it? Well, I'll tell you what. One of our former staff members who left in 1972, just retired from a position at the National Gallery of Art in Washington, D.C. He was head of the conservation lab. And he went and looked in his garage and he found a box. And in the box was a little tin, you know, one of the things you get, that stuff at Christmas that nobody eats. What the heck is that stuff called, you know? Fruitcake. And in the fruitcake was the silver bowl. And I says, well, the thing had been away from, you know, 1972 to 1986 in his garage. He's a museum professional. How can this be? He says, well, my successor packed up my stuff at the museum, and he probably didn't notice that he picked up this thing with a silver bowl in it. Forget the fact it said Baltimore Museum of Art on the outside and had an accession number on it. You know what that's about. Well, you know, it would be kind of odd, but it was also very interesting because it was the same person. The name I had heard in May was the name of the guy, right? The guy died 8 months later. He was making things right. He had regrets. He'd kept this stuff from the early 50s, in fact, and finally, as he approached death, gave them back. So what do you think that might have to do with anything? Okay. So the trial takes place in Northern Virginia on the 10th of January, 2014. And I go down there, and sure enough, the judge puts her gavel down. She's quite irritated with Renoir girl, who didn't even show up at this one-day ruling, or bench ruling. And the judge said, well, you know, a thief cannot convey good title in American jurisprudence. It has to go back to the Baltimore Museum of Art. Very clearly, what was stolen overnight from 14 to 15 of November 1951 is one and the same with this painting on the easel right over there that the FBI trucked over just this morning. Baltimore Museum Art, you can have it back. It should never have gone anyplace. It belonged to you all this time. So after 63 years, it's finally going back to its home and its museum. And so I leave this very brief judicial affair. And it's raining that day. I'm standing under the arches of the courthouse. And opposite me, slightly farther away than that wall, are five sets of television cameras with reporters. Because this has gotten a whole lot of press in the Washington, D.C. area. And it was drizzling. And so nobody was walking across the street. They wanted to see Marsha May Fuqua, Renoir girl, a 51-year-old driving instructor with the, you know, plastic garbage bag and the Paul Bunyan doll, but she was nowhere to be seen, and they figured that out. So they walked. One of the reporters walked across the street and said to me, are you Matt Marsha May's brother? And I said, no. Over my left shoulder, I heard a high voice say, here he is, here he is. Turn around, and there's Matt, and he's standing there with a woman who introduces herself to the reporter as Jamie Romantic, with a C. Now, I can tell you that for reasons that are not totally clear to me, In an instant, I recognized Jamie Romantic as a pole dancer. I knew in an instant her day job, or probably her night job, was pole dancing. But Matt Fuqua had latched on to Jamie Romantic, who had aspirations of importance beyond Matt Fuqua. How do I know that? Because when they went across the street to be interviewed, they raced across the street. The reporters didn't know what to ask them because they wanted to talk to Renoir Girl, who was nowhere to be seen. So I told one of the reporters to ask Matt if his mother, now deceased from cancer, had stolen this painting from the Baltimore Museum of Art. And he said, oh no, my mother wouldn't do this. My mother wasn't a thief, and anybody could have figured that out. She was a 23-year-old sophomore at Goucher College. She sure as hell could not get into the Baltimore Museum of Art, the Walters Art Museum, then gallery, and Hopkins University Museum. It just wasn't going to happen. So at that point, Jamie Romantic stepped forward. And you've all seen, at one time in your life, and maybe more than once, Sunset Boulevard. William Holden is face down in the pool. Reporters are taking the pictures. Max von Stroheim is about to ask Norma Desmond to come down the stairs. You with me? Somebody's seen that, haven't they? That is Jamie Romantic at that moment. She had her chance. So she steps in front of Matt, looking straight into the camera, and she said, as if she'd been born with this knowledge. Yes, Matt's mother had lots of boyfriends, and one of them worked at the Baltimore Museum of Art. So you might say case closed, or you might say, Vikan, in your detective's zeal, having now tracked down the thief from these other pieces of evidence, how do you know that this same person was at the Baltimore Museum of Art and could have had access to that specific painting, which was in a little exhibition overnight in November of 51? What did I do? I went to the annual report. Only like 12 staff members. I found the name, four from the top. Word to the right, what was his job? Superintendent of buildings. So 35-year-old X, this man, who was then 35, was almost certainly the boyfriend of, in fact, there's no doubt of, the 23-year-old Goucher sophomore. That in November, my guess is, he became infatuated with the fact that Renoir had dashed this off for his girlfriend, that it had been given, he's a very clever guy, by Sadie May. So he took it out of the exhibition case overnight and gave it to his girlfriend, Marcia May Fuqua, who then took it off to suburban Washington, D.C. and stuck it on her wall, where it remained for 62 years. End of story. Thank you. So I've probably gone over my time, but do you have any questions? I'd be happy to. No, I haven't. I got 3 minutes.
Yes, sir. We'll take questions.
Are you up to date on the Isabel Stewart Gardner case?
Am I up to date on Isabella Stewart Gardner? I mean, insofar as something may have happened in the last 2 weeks, no. I think generally, you may know something that I don't, but generally speaking, I think the case was fairly close to having been solved 10 years ago, and it fell through. Unless you know things that I don't, I think the New England Mafia is a player in this. They had an insider that helped them get in overnight on St. Patrick's Day in March of 1990, and those paintings are probably sitting much as those two Van Goghs were sitting in in a warehouse, actually, of a mafioso guy in Italy until they finally reemerged. And, you know, there's a $5 million reward. And I think if somebody could negotiate, you know, Dominique did a brilliant job, and she did it herself, even though she had Brownell. Herbert Brownell, who was the Attorney General for Eisenhower, was representing her in the Fresco case. I think she actually came up with the deal that got it done. And I think somebody could come up with a deal to get that $5 million moving in the right direction and the paintings come back. You know, there are only 13 items, but the appraised value was probably in the $500 million range, whereas that thing, once the FBI got a hold of it, they had it reappraised, $20,000. You cannot get a Renoir cheaper than that. And I think the thief was very careful to keep below the radar. The Walters never reported the theft of that Coptic plaque. They did report that. And in fact, they got a payoff in 1951 from the insurance company of $2,000. So if you ran the numbers forward, it'd probably be on the order of 50 or 60. I've never done that. I didn't get a chance to say goodbye to the dog.
I was wondering if you could recount a little bit of your stories with or about J.J. Kletchman.
One more time?
I was just wondering if you could recount. Sorry, I was just wondering if you could recount a little bit more or a little bit about your encounters with or J.J. Kletchman?
With this collection?
With him as a person, as a dealer, J.J. Kletchman?
Oh, Kletchman.
Yeah.
Yeah, I never met Kletchman. He was a major dealer. He had a shop on Madison Avenue. I think it was Madison Avenue in the 60s. Kletchman was sold to everybody who bought things Byzantine. Dumbarton Oaks, the Walters. And John and Dominique bought 820 items from him in 1962. And the reason my adventure with Dominique happened at all was because those 820 objects that they bought in 1962 never came to Texas. They went instead to the vault in the bedroom of Marvin Ross, who was retained by Dominique to publish them. And he died in March of 1977. He had an office opposite mine at Dumbarton Oaks. So I got a call. I guess it was a call from the director of Dumbarton Oaks, and said he had been contacted by a lawyer in suburban Washington by the name of Perez, who was acting on behalf of a wealthy woman in Texas. I don't remember that I was told the name. And Perez said she wanted to have somebody go over to the apartment of the recently deceased Marvin Ross, who lived on California Avenue, just north of the Phillips, California Street, and match up those 820 little bronzes from Byzantium that had been fished off the shores of the Bosphorus by George Zakos, not Kletchman. Zakos was the source of that stuff. Kletchman just fronted for Zakos. But in any event, I went and sat on this guy's bed with photographs that had been commissioned from a Washington photographer by Marvin Ross. And that was the only evidence that the Menil Foundation, that Dominique had, that these items belonged to her. So I matched everyone up. I was short one. The one I didn't have was a little gold key. And a little gold key had been sitting on the desk of Marvin Ross when he went off to the hospital and died. He had cancer and he had heart disease. So I'm standing in Marvin Ross's apartment, and Marvin Ross's two sisters are sitting there at his desk, and they're really angry. They're angry at Dominique de Menil, who they don't know from Adam or Eve. And they're angry at her because her lawyer is taking Marvin's books literally off his bookshelves because he bought those books with her money and all of his papers that reflected work that he'd been paid by her to do. So from the lawyer's point of view and Dominique's point of view, this was their property. She'd paid for that. He never produced the catalog. The sisters were really angry. And only a year later did I find out from the good sister, by way of Mary Jane Victor, that the bad sister had picked that gold key up off his desk and put it in her pocket. So I had to track her down in Riverhead, Long Island. I walked into her house, little frame house, about that would have fit in this room almost. And she was so angry at me. She said, if you ever come back, if you ever send me a letter, if any lawyer ever sends me a letter, or if I ever get a letter from what seems to be a lawyer, I'm going to take that gold tea and flush it down the toilet. And so I have a chapter in there that describes how I saved that gold key that day from the toilet. And I forget what day of the week it was. Must have been Monday, or it was Tuesday. And how I had it shipped down to Washington, and I thought it was lost in mail. And I can still see Dominique coming into Dumbarton Oaks, because I was standing in the hallway in front of a case where I was going to put this gold key, which now fit with the Dumbarton Oaks gold ring. And I despaired that I would ever see it. I thought it had been lost in the mail. And Dominique was coming to see me. She was wearing that white ermine, whatever it is that she wore, that fur coat. It was late October and very cold out. And I saw her walk in the door, and right behind her was a mailman. And the mailman had a little box. In the box was the gold key. So she stood in front of that case when we put the key in, opened it up, took the little gold key out, and put it with its ring. And if when you read the book, you'll find that the gold key and the gold ring had been separated 1,000 years ago. But it was a great story and a great introduction to Dominique. She insisted that she wasn't going to buy the ring back or the gold key back because it belonged to her. John had paid for it. I saw his canceled check. He'd only paid $200 for it. He bought it directly from George Sakos in 68. But she says, you know, this is mine. I'm not going to pay for it. But Mary Jane Victor told me that Dominique told her, I could offer the woman a refrigerator. This is true. So I've been sitting there and thinking to myself and talking to her and trying to sweet talk this woman. You know, I'm from Minnesota. I don't get this. You know, I just didn't figure this out. I'm from a little town. Why should people behave like this? So trying to figure out what to do. And finally, she decides to make me a sandwich for lunch. So I follow her into the kitchen. And I'm about to tell her, you know, if you want a new refrigerator, I think I could arrange that. But before I could say it, she says, you know, I just got a new refrigerator. I know exactly where I was standing when she said she had this damn refrigerator. But I did finally get that key back. But that, you asked about Klejman. But Klejman was sort of like Yanni Patsopoulos in the relationship to Aidan Diekman. Diekman and Zappos were sort of alike. In other words, they both had money. They both had channels going out. Zako sold out of the Grand Bazaar in Istanbul. That's what he was. He's one of those people. His father did the same thing. But he had channels that could get the stuff to Madison Avenue, could get this stuff to Houston, could get this stuff into Dumbarton Oaks. So he was the Diekman of his age. The difference between Aidan Diekman in 1983 and George Zakos in 1962 is that what was appropriate, acceptable, and commonplace in 62 was a little less acceptable, appropriate, and commonplace in 83, and it's now totally unacceptable and almost never happens. The world is very different now from the world when we could celebrate the inside of a church in that room. I mean, you know, that seems like 1,000 years ago now. So I could sign some books if you haven't, you know, they make good Cinco de Mayo presents, good Set in May presents. They make good presents for Thursday. You can give them people you don't even know. They would say, why did you do that? You could talk about the dog a little bit. You know, there's no end of good reasons to buy my book and give it to anybody. Pass it forward, so to speak. It's a mitzvah. Thank you.
Thank you.